assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to Shishi Guru and Gauranga. So we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 11, Text 58. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskrityam. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Saraswati Vyasam. Tato Jayam Udirae. Before reciting the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is the very means of conquest, one should offer respectful obeisances unto the personality of Godhead, Narayan, unto Narayan Rishi, the supermost human being, and unto Mother Saraswati, the goddess of learning, and unto Srila Vyasadeva, the author. Nasta prayesu abhadresu nityam bhagavat sevaya bhagavate uttam shloke bhaktir bhavati nashtaki. By regular attendance in classes on the Bhagavatam and by rendering of service to the pure devotees, all that is troublesome to the heart is almost completely destroyed. And loving service under the personality of Godhead, who is praised with transcendental songs, is established as an irrevocable fact.
Iti nanda dayo gopa Krishna Rama katam muda Kurvanto Rama Manascha Navindan Bhava Vedanam. Eti Nandadayo Gopa Krishna Rama Katam Muda Kurvanto Rama Manascha Navindan Bhava Vedanam. Eti Nandadayo Gopa Krishna Rama Katam Muda Kurvanto Rama Manascha Navindan Bhava Vedanam.
Please recite.
Nandadayo Gopa Kurvanto Rama Manascha Bhava Vedana Ete Nandadayo Gopa Krishna Rama Katam Muda Kurvanto Rama Manascha.
Vaishnavis.
Ananda Gopa Sharama Katamuda Kurvanto Rama Manascha. Inda Bhavedana. Iti Nanda Dayo Gopa.
Word meaning iti in this way. Nanda Adaya, all the cowherd men headed by Nanda Maharaj. Gopa, cowherd men. Krishna Rama Katam, narration of incidents in connection with Bhagwan Krishna and Rama. Muda, in great transcendental pleasure. Kurvanta, doing that. Ramamana, yeah, that shouldn't be just. Cha, enjoyed life and increased their affection for Krishna. Na, not. Avindan, perceived. Bhava Vedanam, the tribulations of material existence. Translation purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki. In this way, all the cowherd men headed by Nanda Maharaj enjoyed topics about the pastimes of Krishna and Balaram with great transcendental pleasure, and they could not even perceive material tribulations. Please repeat after me. In this way, all the cowherd men, headed by Nanda Maharaj, enjoyed topics about the pastimes of Krishna and Balaram with great transcendental pleasure. And they could not even perceive material tribulations. Purport. Here is an instruction about the result of studying or discussing the Krishna Leelas that appear in Srimad Bhagavatam. Sadyo hirdi avarudyate atra kriti bi shushrubi stat sanat. That is from Bhagavatam 1, canto 1, text 1, canto 1, chapter 1, text 2. Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda in Vrindavan appeared like ordinary persons of this material world. But they never felt the tribulations of this world. Although they sometimes met many dangerous situations created by the demons, this is a practical example. If we follow in the footsteps of Nanda Maharaj and the Gopas, we can all be happy simply by discussing the activities of Krishna. Anarthopasamam saksa bhakti yogam adoksache lokasya janato vidvans chakre satvata samhitam. That's from Bhagavad Gita 176. Vyasadeva was given this literature so that everyone may understand one's transcendental position simply by discussing Bhagavad Katha. Even at the present moment, everyone everywhere can be happy and free from material tribulations by following Srimad Bhagavatam. There is no need of austerities and penances, which in this age are very difficult to perform. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has therefore declared Sarvatma Snapanam Param Vijate Sri Krishna Sankirtanam. By our Krishna consciousness movement, we are trying to distribute Srimad Bhagavatam so that anyone in any part of this world can be absorbed in the Krishna consciousness movement by chanting and hearing about the activities of Krishna and be free from all material tribulations. I'm also going to read text 59 just because it's going to be the end of the chapter, and then tomorrow we can start from the next chapter. I'll just read it alone. Evam viharai kormarai kaumaram jahatur vraje nilayanai setu bandair markatot palavana dibi. In this way, Krishna and Balaram passed their childhood age in Vrajabhumi by engaging in activities of childish play, such as playing hide and seek, constructing a make-believe bridge on the ocean, and jumping here and there like monkeys. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purpose of the 10th canto, 11th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam entitled The Childhood Pastimes of Krishna. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Shrimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Dinamine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesa Sunyavadi Pastatada Satarine Om Gyanam Timirandasya Gyananjana Salakya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namah. Before I start speaking, I will seek the blessings and mercy of all the senior Vaishnavas here, that I may be able to speak something on the science of Krishna consciousness in the footsteps of Jagadguru Srila Prabhupada for the benefit of myself and all of us who are trying to practice in this science of Krishna consciousness. In this way, all the cowherd men headed by Nanda Maharaj enjoyed topics about the pastimes of Krishna and Balaram with great transcendental pleasure, and they could not even perceive material tribulations. Srila Prabhupada comments that the greatest profit in life is to achieve personal loving service to the Lord. So, as we can see in the purport, Srila Prabhupada mentions that just by speaking Bhagavad Katha and reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, all anxieties and tribulations are cast away. So we can see the potency and the power of devotional life, or trying to at least endeavor towards this path. That's why Srila Prabhupada is mentioning very clearly that this is the greatest profit in life. You know, and he uses the word profit because in the material world, the terminology used nowadays is P&Ls, profit and loss statements. How well you're performing is based on your P&Ls. If you ever go to Swavas Prabhu's office, he always has BBT, temple expenses. He's always looking at the P&Ls or balance sheets and all that. Am I correct, Prabhu? Because that is what gauges your performance. And so Srila Prabhupada very clearly uses the word profit. That the greatest profit in life is to achieve personal love in service to the Lord. He says personal love in service to the Lord. So puts a lot of emphasis, puts a lot of essence in what we are trying to do here as devotees. Real education means to give up the false idea that anything is separate from the Lord. So he further states in his purports that the real education means to give up the false idea that anything is separate from the Lord. As we know that the jivas are qualitatively the same as the Supreme Lord because we are eternal sparks, but quantitatively we are different. So the reason we are here, because of that having the same quality of independence that the Supreme Personality of Godhead has, it is inherent in us. It is in our DNA. So because it is inherent in us, this is a very important point that we need to also look at, that real education means giving up the false idea that we are separate from the Lord. Because the first reason why we are suffering in this material world is because we want to be independent. And independent of who? Independent of the Supreme Personality of the Lord. We want to serve our own senses. We don't want to serve the senses of the Supreme Personality of God. We want to lord over everything that we survey. You know, that is the material propensity, that we want to be the lords of all that we survey. And because of that independence being used in connection with the material elements, you see that we are not actually happy or transcendentally situated, but we have a lot of anxiety. So Srila Prabhupada very clearly mentions that in line with what the purport is saying, that devotional service begins with one's hearing of the Lord's activities, Krishna Katha. And that's why we have the nine processes of devotional service, starting with Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam. Shravanam, hearing. So the first process is hearing. And hearing what? Hearing Krishna Katha. And towards this, in the Bhagavad Gita, Chapter 6, in Dhyan Yoga, Srila Prabhupada mentions in his purpose, after I go through the shlokas, about the mind. For him who has conquered the mind is the best of friends. But for one who has failed to do so, his mind will remain the greatest enemy. So this is very important, because Srila Prabhupada comments that you're either sleeping with your enemy in the form of the mind dictating to you what needs to be done, or you have the best of friends alongside you. Because the mind is the one that is driving our desires. Obviously, we have intelligence also. So, if we are having doubts about this process, or we have other desires, then it is basically because our mind is our enemy or our friend. And further, in the next shloka, Srila Prabhupada mentions, for man, mind is the cause of bondage and mind is the cause of liberation. Mind absorbed in sense objects is the cause of liberation. And therefore, the mind which is always engaged in Krishna consciousness is the cause of supreme liberation. So, very key here that the mind, when it is absorbed or engaged in Krishna consciousness, it is the cause of supreme liberation. So, with that being said, one who cannot control the mind lives with the greatest enemy. And we know that yesterday Maharaj was mentioning about the constitutional position of the jiva, the soul, which is atato brahma jigyasa, which is that living entity is to carry out the order of someone. Who is that someone? The order of a superior. That's what Srila Prabhupada writes in his purpose, that we are meant to be carrying in constitutional position, the living entity is meant to be carrying out the order of the superior. And the superior is the Supreme Personality of Godhead and his bona fide representatives. So real yoga practice entails meeting the Paramatma within the heart and then following his dictation. We all know that we have the Paramatma feature in our heart, which is guiding us as the ever well wisher. So when we are actually in properly fixed in our devotional service, that's what my understanding was of real yoga. It means that from the heart, the Lord is giving you the dictation. So by taking to Krishna consciousness directly, perfect surrender to the dictation of the Lord automatically follows. And in the purport, Srila Prabhupada mentions that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is therefore declared Sarvatma Sanapanam Param Vijate Sri Krishna Sankirtanam. There is no hard and fast regulative principles to follow. This process is joyfully performed. Why is it joyfully performed? Because when you are engaged in this service, you do not have to do the penances and austerities. It automatically comes just by doing the service. And because this transcendental position is at once achieved by one who is Krishna consciousness, the devotee of the Lord is unaffected by the dualities of material existence, namely distress and happiness, cold and heat, etc. This state is practical samadhi, or absorption in the supreme. So again, the emphasis is being placed on how sublime the process is, what are the benefits of the process. Once situated in this process, what are their symptoms? You know, we are not affected by happiness and distress, because we know, as in the Bhagavad Gita, it says that this is just like the coming of the summer and winter seasons. So, further, there is a very nice shloka about devotional service. And this, we know, is one of the essences, because this is spoken by Srila Rupa Goswami himself. Because there is something that Rupa Goswami says in this shloka, which is very important for us to grasp. Because just like Prabhupada used initially the words profit, the translation that is used here is intense greed. So, you know, we have greed, because we know that lust and greed are the prime factors that we are not able to approach or surrender to the process of devotional service. Therefore, intense greed is being used by Rupa Goswami. And what does Rupa Goswami? And we know this is the famous shloka. Krishna bhakti rasa bhavitamati kriyatam yadi kuto api labhyate tatra lalam api mulyam ekalam janma koti shukrate no labhyate. Pure devotional service in Krishna consciousness cannot be had even by pious activity in hundreds and thousands of lives. It can be attained only by paying one price, that is intense greed to obtain it. If it is available somewhere, one must purchase it without delay. There is also the word purchase being used. So you can see how elevated Rup and Sanatan and our Goswamis were, because obviously we knew they held very exalted positions in the Muslim government. But you can see Rupa Goswami says intense greed. We must have intense greed. So you can see how the dovetailing of our consciousness is being applied. We have greed towards hankering after material objects. Here we are dovetailing that same consciousness to have intense greed to obtain what? To obtain what? Krishna. And that if it is available somewhere, you must purchase it without fail. The word purchase is being used. So this is very critical, because we are, what are we called? We are called Rupanugas, followers of Lord, of which Goswami? Rupa Goswami. And what is Rupa Goswami's instruction to us? Intense greed. And what is the condition? There is no condition. Purchase it without any condition. And that is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said. What did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu say? You are my Lord unconditionally, whether you embrace me or you are not present before me, or you make me broken hearted. You are my Lord unconditionally. So you know, sometimes devotees are looking for new messages. You know, marketing is a very powerful tool today. Does anyone know how many times a message has to hit you before it starts embedding in you? Does anyone know how many times, that, you know, you see billboards, you see ads running. You see, even in if you listen to radio or newspaper, there's a lot of ads running. Why do you think they repeat itself? Brainwashing. Yes. Yes, but in marketing, it says at least 10 times before it starts making the effect. So, you know, sometimes we are looking for new things, but the core things that we are Rupanugas, what is the instruction of Rupa Goswami to us? That we should have intense greed. This is a point we should hammer within ourselves. We should have intense greed to do what? To purchase this service. Why? Because when the Lord is purchased by pure devotional service, he becomes what? He becomes purchased by the devotee. And that is what we are seeing in this. That pure devotees like Nand Maharaj and Yashoda can do all these activities. It is on the platform of pure love. So, since we know this and we are practicing this, then why are we not surrendering? Because surrender is being hampered by our false ego, Srila Prabhupada says, of I and mine. What is there for me? What is there for I? I am something, I am someone. I will do things this way, or I will do things this way, or I will do them under conditions. And that is what is hampering our surrender. So towards this, I'm going to speak about the six processes of submissive surrender, which are outlined by our great Acharya Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So what are the six processes of submissive surrender? Does anyone know the one process of submissive surrender? Yes. Accept everything that is favorable for devotional life. Again, that's also an instruction that Rupa Goswami also gives us in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So accept things favorable for devotional service. Towards that, We know what are the things that are favorable for devotional service. Can someone outline a few? What are some of the things that are favorable for devotional service? Chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Reading Srimad Bhagavatam and listening to Srimad Bhagavatam, which is what we are doing. Sadhu Sangha. Living in a holy place, which is New Dwarkadham. Harinam Sankirtan. So you can see we are engaged in these activities. So, very clear, we are engaged in these activities. What is the second item that is one of the processes of submissive surrender out of the six? Yes, Prabhu. True. Yes. So rejecting things that are unfavorable for devotional service. Now, we know that that will be the opposite of what we have just said. But let's get some examples. What are some of the things that are unfavorable for devotion? Yes. 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 Why? Because we're wasting our time. And that's what Bhaktivinoda Thakur in his Saranagati prayers is repeatedly mentioning that I have lost so much valuable time. I've lost so much valuable time. I've lost so much valuable time. Even Srila Prabhupada, founder Acharya of ISKCON, did state to us that, you know, he started at a very ripe age to bring this broadcast. But he said, you guys are young, go ahead and start this right away. Because time is something that is beyond our control. You know, in the material world, when they're celebrating a birthday, actually, if you look at it, instead of celebrating, you should be doing a recollection that I'm actually losing 1 year of my life here. But they are celebrating. You can see how much we are in ignorance today. We are celebrating happy birthday. Instead of saying, just recollect yourself that you're actually 1 year less. Srila Prabhupada was actually mentioning in a very powerful lecture I was hearing. And he was asking, how many more years of your life do you have? And the gentleman said, I think something like 20 or 30 years. Srila Prabhupada said, are you sure you have 20 to 30 years? He says, yeah. Srila Prabhupada said, no, you only have half of that. Because half of the time you're sleeping. So, this is Atato Brahm Jigyasa, wake up. Jiva Jago Gora Chandra Bole, Kota Nitra Jago Maya Tisa Chira Bole. Jiva Jago, wake up now. We have been sleeping for too long in the lap of Maya. We are in so much illusion that we are not even aware that we are dying and we are celebrating that death. So, reject things unfavorable. Which is the third one? Because we are looking at the processes of surrender. Because surrender is very important. Because without surrender, nothing happens. So, anyone knows? I see Prabhu is already on the internet there, you know. I'm sorry? So, I will continue. Atma Nivedanam, self-surrender. Remembering that one's activities and desires are not independent. Atma Nivedanam, which is self-surrender. And towards that, I would like to read something that Bhaktivinoda Thakur has actually compiled in his Saranagati prayers on Atma Nivedanam. So just give me a moment, because, you know, there was a few, you know, there's a lot of prayers. It's 50 songs. So I just took up some of the verses that relate to today's purport and that are very clear, because this is Bhaktivinoda Thakur, one of our greatest acharyas, telling us about Atma Nivedanam. So just give me a moment here and I will pull that up here shortly. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur, as we know, has in the Saranagati prayers, he has on the first principle of surrender, which is humility, just for your information, he has 7 songs. And then on the second principle of surrender, Atma Nivedana, or the dedication of the self, he has 8 songs. And on the third principle of surrender, which is acceptance of the Lord as your soul maintainer, he has 4 songs. And on the fourth principle of surrender is that the Lord is your protector, he has, I'm just looking at it, they have not mentioned how many he has, but he has on that also. So what are the, what does Bhaktivinoda Thakur speak about Atma Nivedanan is what I want to just go straight to. So he says, all there is that may be indicated by the words aham, I, and mama, mine, I offered at your lotus feet, O merciful Lord. So Atma Nivedanam, I and mine, he is offering that at the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. I no longer consider even myself to be mine, O Lord. Now I have become exclusively yours. That is the second prayer that he does. Then he says, the soul inhabiting this mortal body has given up the false ego attached to the word I. For today the spiritual sense of being yours has entered his heart. So that is where Atma Nivedanam is starting from. I and mine is being offered by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur at the lotus feet of the Lord. Then he continues to say, just give me a moment here. He continues to say, the conditioned soul thinks that all the things related to the false conceptions of I and mine are his exclusive treasures, calling them his own. His mind is firmly convinced of this gross delusion. So, very clear that we as conditioned souls, anything which I perceive or which is within my realm of I and mine is mine, is mine, is mine. We are so attached to it, like Prabhu said, over endeavoring for things that actually is one of the unfavorable items in devotional service. Because we look at everything and are so attached to it. So that is why Bhaktivinoda Thakur prays that this is a gross delusion. Then he also continues to say on Atma Nivedanam, all the troubles encountered in your service, which service are we talking about? Which service is Bhaktivinoda Thakur talking about? He says, all the troubles encountered in your service, in your devotional service, shall be the cause of great happiness, for in your devotional service, joy and sorrow are equally great riches. Both destroy the misery of ignorance. So he's very clearly pointing out that in your devotional service, both joy and sorrow derived from this service are our greatest riches. Not miseries. I have extra service to do. I have to go and cover for so and so pujari. No, these are our greatest riches. Both destroy the misery of ignorance. So some of the prayers towards Atma Nivedanam. And then I'm going to go to the next point, because I'm looking at time. You know, here time is already 8:15. So we have spoken about accepting things that are favorable, accepting things that are unfavorable. We have spoken about Atma Nivedanam, which is surrender, which is the fourth one, that Krishna will give me full protection. And towards that, I have to be firmly convinced that I will get full protection. You know, in the Bhagavad Gita, we have through Arjun, the Lord says, Kaunteya pradijani name bhaktam pranasyanti. O son of Kunti, declare boldly that my devotee never perishes. So, what does Bhaktivinoda Thakur have to say about the process of accepting the Lord as your protector? So Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, and I because of time, I'm just going to summarize that. Basically, it is key that we have trust in the words of the Supreme Personality of God. The Lord is speaking to us directly and reassuring us that this process, there is no diminution or loss on this path. And any advancement made in the Bhagavad Gita, any advancement made on this path will protect us from the greatest fear. So we should have trust as devotees and firm conviction that the Lord is going to do that. And there are so many practical examples in Srimad Bhagavatam, the Shastra that we are reading, of how the Lord is protecting. He protected Prahlad Maharaj several times. Several times. So that is, but Prahlad Maharaj also had that faith. And the faith was that he knew that the Supreme Personality of Godhead will protect him. I'm just going to wrap it up, because if I go through everything, it may be longer. So we have spoken about the fourth, accepting Krishna as the supreme maintainer. And then accepting Krishna that he will give me protection. And then the sixth one is that the devotee is meek and humble. And towards meek and humble, Srila Prabhupada very clearly states that chanting Hare Krishna should be continued without stoppage, because will protect a devotee from all accidental fall downs. He will remain perpetually free from all material contaminations. So on the topic of devotee being meek and humble, very clear instructions by Srila Prabhupada that chanting Hare Krishna should be continued without stoppage. And obviously, then he mentions that if you're not getting the desired results, then you have to be careful about the 10 offenses. And as long as you're careful of the 10 offenses and you are chanting, then you will, he says, that you will be protected from all accidental fall downs. And that material contaminations will not be able to touch you. So again, we know that this is a prime instruction in the Sikshastakam prayers by Lord Chaitanya, the chanting of the holy names. And the power, because he says Nam Nam Akari Bhauja Nija Sarva Saktis. In the names, all the potencies are invested. So the power of chanting is key. And Srila Prabhupada mentions that through the nine process of Shravanam Kirtanam, which also includes chanting, cleanses all material contamination of the heart, and continuous thinking of the Supreme Lord makes him pure by nature. Because we are listening. We're listening constantly, we're listening. Or we are listening to the Naam. When we are chanting, you're actually listening to the Naam. So when you're listening to the Naam, it is also making us pure by nature. I will strongly recommend us reading the Sarnagati prayers by Bhaktivinoda Thakur, because he actually states, because of time, I'm not actually going into it, but for each and every process of surrender, he is giving wonderful prayers and instructions to us on why it is important and what we are trying to control. Hare Krishna. Any questions? Yes, Nilapur.
Like P&L profit, and you were talking about that, like business. I wanted to just ask you a little bit, to go a little bit into detail with that, because from what I've observed is that, you know, if businesses, of course, we all require money, you know, to a certain extent, but if it's so much on the business side, it seems like the people in general, they like silly things, like paintings of dogs, cones, snow cones, watermelon. I was marveling that during Rath Yatra, the books, I thought we sold a lot of books at the book table, and it was about, the Lakshmi was about 1,500, and then watermelon and snow cones did 3,000. So I was just observing that if it's only about profit instead of substance, that people choose silly things. They buy all kinds of nonsense things with, you know, with their money. But something that is going to actually benefit them, like books, and or you take, for example, these wonderful paintings we have. People will spend hundreds of dollars on a painting of a dog, but a transcendental painting, you know, they won't pay money for it, even though it's billions of times superior. So I was just thinking of that, how one thing Prabhupada mentions is like there was a sweet vendor and he made it, cooked all his sweets in ghee versus the other guys, they use oil. And so if it's just about profit, the person is thinking, okay, if I do oil, I save so much money. But the person who did ghee, over time, people start to realize, wow, these sweets are much better. And then he has the line all the way around the block, you know, like that. So I was just thinking, could you explain a little bit more on what's good quality versus just profit?
You see, my understanding on this is whenever we're looking at profit, we are looking at profit from the point of sustaining our material bodies. But we are eternal. Jiva Swarup, you know, constitutionally, Jiva is eternal. So what we are doing is nourishing the body and trying to nourish any paraphernalia associated with the body. But when Srila Prabhupada is mentioning about, or Rupa Goswami is saying about this profit, this is the real profit because it is for the Atma. I will also let senior devotees chip in and tell if I'm wrong. But my understanding is that the real profit is nourishing the root of the tree and not the leaves. And that root is the soul. Am I correct in that, Drutakarma Prabhu?
But loses the soul.
Exactly, yes. So I hope that clarifies. The richness is because we are trying to do the outer body without really doing the soul. Because we know if there's no soul, this body is worthless. So the real richness is the one that affects the soul because it is directly for the Atma. Any other comments? Any other questions? Yes, Sachitananda.
The question was about why somebody invests or buys other things instead, like he mentioned about these beautiful paintings or art or something. But we've seen that most of the people invest their money in whichever produces sense gratification. If it gratifies your senses, then you're ready to pay millions of dollars. But if it doesn't mean anything to you, you don't see any value.
You see, this is because of the perception that people do not know that there is life after death. A lot of people take, you know, in the material world, I have one life, I have to enjoy this to the best. That is the conception. That's the first ignorance. That, you know, I only have this one life. And I should enjoy it to the maximum. I will go and take this, I'll do this. Why? Because the conception is that I only have one life. So through the jnana, through the knowledge that, hey, this is a cycle of repeated birth and death. When someone gets that awareness, then they start thinking outside the box. Because as the Bible says, as you shall sow, so shall you reap. It very clearly states in one of the Ten Commandments, as you shall sow, so shall you reap. But the question here is, how is someone relating to it? You know, so the materialists, why they are called materialists, it's the world is materialist. There's capitalists and communists. Capitalists is America. Capitalize on everything. You know, it comes from the noun capitalize. What does capitalize mean? Capitalize means you need to be ahead of the game. I need to capitalize on this opportunity before someone else capitalizes on it. So there is always that rush on that platform. But what is happening is that they are doing that because they are in so much gross ignorance that they do not know that after this, there is another life. And that will be subjected to our actions, what we do this life. So once that knowledge comes in, then I think people start understanding things in a better light. But until they don't understand that, they will lord it over material nature. Because that's what the school systems teach us. When you go to school, Prabhu is a teacher. If you go to business school, you're told how to be ahead of the game. I know this because I have a master's also in business, you know. So all we are taught is, how do you be ahead of the game?
You can't be behind the game. You have to be in front. It's called changing the paradigm. Either you change the paradigm or someone is going to change the paradigm on you. Means he's going to pull the carpet on you. Either you're going to be catching that person or you want others to catch you. Why? Because that is the system. The system is capitalize. Be ahead. Because we're not following Srimad Bhagavatam. We're not following the transcendental scriptures that, hey, this hankering business is like chewing the chewed. It's never gonna satisfy us. In fact, there was one Prabhu was telling me, he met someone in the plane. This guy actually, he develops products. And he said a very interesting thing in the plane. He says, one of my key things is how to not only develop a product, but how to create a need for that product. So what they do is they create a product, then his mind is thinking, how do I create a need for this so people start buying the product? Through advertisements, promotions, but they create a need. So it's not that we need it, but a need is being created. But a person in proper knowledge knows that this is not required. This is key. But it is the entire system, because from the schools they teach us all that. Yeah. You know, it's like Prabhupada says, the blind are following the blind. You know, Swawas Prabhu told me, wrap it up. So, you know, when the boss says, you have to close all the business. So, Srimad Bhagavatam class ki. Yeah. Just read Srila Prabhupada's books, everything is there.